Hi, and welcome back to Understanding Motors. Last episode, we introduced the idea of the Clark and Park transformations and closed with the question of how we would go about minimizing torque ripple in a motor's commutation. As we showed last time, when performing six-block commutation, the currents along the Q and D axis vary as the rotor turns, with the torque being minimized at the transition point between Hall sectors. This episode, we're going to start working towards a commutation method which eliminates these variations. So, let's get into it. We're going to start this episode by performing a thought experiment. What if, instead of having three Hall sensors spaced 120 degrees apart, we had six sensors, spaced such that they evenly divided the motor's rotation into 12 30-degree sectors? How would we modify our approach to block commutation for this theoretical 12-sector motor to get better performance? Well, let's start by looking at this segment here, where the rotor is turned such that it is aligned with what would have been the transition point between Hall sectors 0 and 1. Ideally, assuming that we're using a non-salient pole motor, we want our current and magnetic field vectors to point in the Q direction, which for this orientation is aligned with the B phase. If we're only connecting two phases at a time, as we did with six-sector block commutation, producing a vector in this direction is not possible. However, as we mentioned in episode 6, because we're controlling each motor phase independently with our three-legged H-bridge, we're not limited to only connecting two phases at a time. So, by connecting node B to ground and nodes A and C to high voltage, we can generate vectors which point strictly in the Q direction for this orientation. For each of the six new Hall sectors added by the new sensors, we can align our current with the Q axis by connecting either two phases to high and one to ground, or two phases to ground and one to high. Okay, so now our current would be better aligned with our Q axis throughout rotation. But connecting more than two phases at a time with 100% duty cycle also has other side effects on our current and, as we will see, on our torque ripple. As we've said several times at this point, the individual phases of the motor can be electrically represented as a resistor, an inductor, and a back EMF-based load. If we connect two phases, as we did with six-sector block commutation, the values of the resistors and the inductors of the two phases will sum, as they would be in series with each other. However, if we're utilizing all three phases, two of the three phases will be in parallel with each other and then in series with the remaining phase. So by utilizing three phases instead of two, the amount of resistance and inductance felt by the current will decrease. I imagine that this may be unclear, so let's do a quick example to better demonstrate this. If a single motor phase has a resistance of 0.5 ohm, connecting two phases in series, as we do in six-sector block commutation, results in a 1-ohm circuit. So, if we put 1 volt across it, we get 1 amp of current running through it. However, if we connect one phase to high and two to ground, or one phase to ground and two to high, the net resistance of the two phases in parallel with each other drops to 0.25 ohm. Therefore, the total resistance is now 0.75 ohm. And if we applied 1 volt to this circuit, 1 1/3 amps would run through it. At first, it might seem like if we're applying 33% more current, we would be generating 33% more torque. However, here we need to go back to our Clark and Park transformations from last episode. If we look at the summation of the vectors, we can see that while using two phases doesn't produce parallel vectors, the vectors produced largely add constructively. However, when we're using all three phases, the phases in parallel end up canceling out more. The result of this is that, while we're running 33% more current through the system, because a larger portion of the vector is canceling along the D-axis, we only end up with about 15% more net magnetic flux. However, that does still mean more torque would be generated during these configurations. So now we've gotten rid of the lowest points of our torque ripple by aligning our flux with the Q-axis, but in doing so we've created a new version of the torque ripple. So how can we get the best of both worlds? A better alignment with the Q axis without the added torque oscillations. Well, let's go back and see what it would look like to run this hypothetical 12-sector motor in the way we've been describing. Our voltages throughout commutation would look like this, and the corresponding current signals would look like this. If we look at these current signals as just individual phases, what we see is that the signals are periodic, and they look a little bit like heavily discretized sine waves, each offset from the last by 120 degrees. So what would happen if instead of running these currents, which look like low resolution, kind of wonky sine waves through our system, we actually just ran three sine waves? Well, buckle up, because it's time for some math. But first, before we get into it, I want to add a disclaimer that I don't really intend for you as a viewer to be able to track each substitution I'm doing in real time. If you're capable of that, that's super great, and you for sure have me beat in the mental math department. But I show each step I took here super quickly, and that's not to make you think that I'm some sort of math savant. It's so that anyone who's curious can go back and pause the video and see the steps taken if they wanted to. Anyway, since this system follows Kirchhoff's current law, we can't define all three currents arbitrarily. So let's start by just defining two. We'll define the currents coming out of A and B as functions of theta, where theta equals 0 corresponds to the d-axis being aligned with the alpha axis. The current flowing out of phase A will be defined equal to negative I times sine of theta, and the current flowing out of phase B will be negative I times sine of theta minus 120. We know from Kirchhoff that the current in A plus the current in B plus the current in C must equal 0. Therefore, we can show that the current in C must be equal to I times the quantity sine of theta plus sine of theta minus 120. Doing some trigonometric substitutions, we find that the current in C must therefore be equal to negative I times sine of theta plus 120. This means that the three sinusoids we showed earlier are a valid combination of currents. But what effect does this have on the currents in our alpha and beta directions? Because it's just equal to the current in A, our alpha current is equal to negative I times sine of theta. Meanwhile, if we plug our B and C currents into the equation we developed for our beta direction current, and then do a few trigonometric substitutions, we find that the current flowing in our beta direction is equal to I times the cosine of theta. Now, if we take our park transformation and move these into the dq reference frame, what do our currents look like? We know our current in the q direction is equal to the current in the alpha direction times the negative sine of theta plus the current in the beta direction times the cosine of theta. Meanwhile, our current in the d direction is equal to the current in the alpha direction times cosine of theta plus the current in the beta direction times sine of theta. Plugging everything in, we see that the currents in the d direction all cancel out, and by using the identity that sine squared plus cosine squared is equal to 1, we can see that the current in the q direction is constant, meaning we've completely gotten rid of our torque ripple. So if we went back and plotted our current in each of our three reference frames, this is what our current would look like in the ABC frame. And then moving to the alpha beta frame, we would have this. Finally, in the DQ axis, our currents are constant and look like this. Thus we see that if we replace the current waveforms from block commutation with sinusoidal currents, we end up minimizing torque ripple and driving our D-axis current to zero. However, the best way of achieving such currents is not necessarily immediately obvious, and this is what we're going to start talking about next episode.